nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hey everyone, welcome to lecture 3.8. So in the last lecture, we were talking about how we can use flexible flux plane methods to accurately capture absorption of individual layers, which is helpful for tandem photovoltaic applications. And now here we're going to actually look at a specific type of tandem photovoltaic system, which has gotten a lot of attention recently, called the perovskite silicon tandem cell. And so there has been a lot of work just in the last year showing that you can actually have a perovskite silicon tandem. Early in 2015 in Applied Physics Letters, it was actually shown you could get efficiency about 13.7%. But less than a year later, just a few months ago, as of the time of this recording, it was actually shown that you could get efficiencies close to 21% for this system by creating both better current matching and stability for the perovskite silicon and better light trapping. So it's been a very rapid rise in progress in this system. Now, there are still some remaining challenges. One, of course, is current matching. And this just kind of showing how the current matching depends on the thickness of the various layers. You can see that there's not necessarily like just one answer, but there are certain ranges that are better than others. Incomplete absorption is certainly a key challenge, where one or more of the layers are which are generating photocurrent are not actually absorbing all the light that they could. There have been approaches to alleviate this using what they call temporary anti-reflection microtextured foils at EPFL, and then basically trying to enhance the absorption. But there are also like issues about parasitic losses in the charge transport layers, which may be optical in nature as well. And so this is just illustrating a little bit about like how bad the parasitic absorption can be, like especially at shorter wavelengths. Oftentimes it's a big problem up to about 500, 550 nanometers. And then even past that, there's still a significant amount. And then finally, there's this stability issue, because perovskites are known to not be as stable as kind of a traditional crystalline silicon type material. And this showing how much they degrade under different conditions. If you put them under stressful conditions like 85°C and 85% humidity, they degrade very rapidly, like within a few hours. So, of course, most people would not use crystalline silicon solar cells under such stressful conditions, but it does illustrate that that's a continuing challenge to improve that. And then, in order to understand the performance of the perovskite silicon tandem cells, first, we just want to go through some recent experiments about how you can basically build perovskite silicon and then measure them. And so this just showing kind of the structure that you could build for a perovskite silicon tandem. The perovskite green is actually the active region, but you can extract current through the aluminum and ITO, and the other layers help extract the carriers. And then that shows like what it looks like. These things are basically the back contacts wrapped around to the front. And then this is showing like what the absorption and parasitic loss mechanisms look like as a function of wavelength. So you can see that actually, although the perovskite itself gets to absorb a fair amount of light in the system, there are also all these extra absorption from layers like the PCBM over here, and then the P dot, which is in yellow or green over here, as well as the reflection of the system, which is very substantial. But it does allow you to actually, like once you've characterized the system, you compare it with this model to estimate what the absorber light harvesting efficiency is. So this does indeed illustrate that if you can get all the light into the perovskite, you can actually harvest a lot of it as electricity, because it's getting close to 100% at 500 nanometers. And even over here at 650, it's still like about 90%. So that's very encouraging set of numbers. But we still have a significant amount of charge transport loss. So in order to characterize the wider bandgap perovskite silicon tandem cells as like kind of an alternative, which may be more stable, here we basically show the structure that was recently published in Science for the perovskite cell. And so it kind of looks like this. And you can see that we can calculate the absorption for both the perovskite and the silicon below it. And you can see that the perovskite and silicon themselves generate a fair amount of photocurrent, but there's a significant current mismatch. So basically, the perovskite has much more current than the crystalline silicon can get. And the reflection is significant. The ITO and FTO absorption are also major factors. And then there's a non-trivial amount of reflection and electrical loss as well. So if we then go to the state-of-the-art perovskite silicon tandem cells that have recently been demonstrated, they kind of look like this. And so this is something that I was alluding to earlier. So you have the crystalline silicon HIT or heterojunction intrinsic transistor cell, and then perovskite silicon or perovskite on top of that, which is similar to what I showed you earlier for the perovskite. And then you can see absorption is actually really high over almost the whole spectrum in the experiment, which is the dotted line. And then our predictions and simulation actually closely match with that. There are a few oscillations that basically just indicate there's probably slight thickness variations that smooth out some of those Fabry-Perot oscillations. And so then if you look at the allocation of absorption to the various regions, you see spiro-ometad, which is the whole transport layer here, actually creates a tremendous amount of parasitic absorption. And so if you, however, of course, got rid of that, then the absorber light harvesting efficiency, again, is really high in both the perovskite and the crystalline silicon. Crystalline silicon is not quite as high, but still pretty good. And so then if you wanted to improve it further, then recent work that was published in Optics Express shows that you could use like an asymmetric dielectric grading to enhance the absorption crystalline silicon, and then you could even use like a thin layer of crystalline silicon without having to use like a full wafer. And so there's been work by Yi Chui's group at Stanford showing that it is certainly possible to lift off and peel off like very thin layers of crystalline silicon, and they can be mechanically stable as well. And so if you combine those thin crystalline silicon and thin perovskite structures, then you can get absorption that looks something like this. And while there is like loss from spiro-ometad, the overall absorption and current matching is actually better than even the state-of-the-art system. And so in, you know, if this was built, this structure, then it would be predicted to have overall efficiency almost 25%. And furthermore, if you get rid of the spiro-ometad whole transport layer, then the efficiency would actually be closer to 27 or 28%. So this kind of illustrates the potential for light trapping in these sorts of tandem cells. In the next lecture, we'll actually talk in more detail about some other applications of finite difference tandemine.